Evening, everybody. Great to be gathering around the Bible together this evening as we do each night. It's our practice as a church to read the Moravian daily readings of the Bible day by day. And each evening we share these short devotionals from the New Testament reading. And that's why we find ourselves in 1 Corinthians 10, the end of the chapter, running into chapter 11 and verse 2 today. And a short, relatively simple reading for the day. And it returns to a theme that Paul has been addressing with the church in this city, this ancient city of Corinth, already. And that is the issue of food. It's a subject that's dear to my heart, as no doubt to many of yours. But in their context, food wasn't just food. Food was a signifier. It spoke to religious identity, it spoke to cultural identity, it spoke to status, and it was also a means of welcome, a means of establishing relationship and community. And in that sense, that will continue to today. But for the believers, they had this issue of what if the food that I'm purchasing or I'm being invited to eat, or even the food that I'm being invited to eat in a particular place, what if it is in some way connected with practices of religion, practices of personal holiness that are contrary to the revealed will of God for the person who wants to follow Jesus faithfully? Now, as we said, Paul has already addressed a lot of that a little earlier in the letter, and you can check out our video devotionals on that as well. But today he's focusing his attention on food and fellowship, that is food and joining together at the table, welcoming one another. And then what's the dynamics? What's really important here? Do we want to have a friendship, a relationship, even share the goodness of Christ with others around the table? Or if the food doesn't match up, then do we dismiss that? Now, I'm not saying if the food doesn't match up, if the quality of the cuisine is not up to spec. How does the reading begin? Well, Paul here again, as he's done numerous times in this letter, he kind of quotes either some things that the Corinthians have shared with him via correspondence, or things that they would both know and understand. So in quote, he says, all things are lawful, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful, but not all things build up. So have the Corinthians said to him, all things are lawful, i.e. because we're in Christ, you know, our consciences are free to do as we please? It's quite possible based on some of their behaviors. But Paul is adding this really helpful qualification. It might be lawful, but is it helpful? It might be lawful, but does it build up? And then he again then roots this in this fundamental reality of what it is to be a Christian. Let no one seek his own good, but the good of his neighbor. And Jesus, when asked to sum up all the law and the prophets, he said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second is like it, the second commandment, Jesus summed everything up into, said, love your neighbor as yourself. Do good to others. You know, we as a church have been concentrating on what it is to be people of welcome and invitation across the divides in our society, across the diversity of our church and local communities. We live in a world that, well, it's trying to wrestle with issues of diversity and find a good way forward, but not always being very successful. We as the people of God can be people of welcome and of invitation. One of the very best ways of doing that is actually around food, isn't it? And sharing food together. What does that look like with our neighbor? Whether it's someone who's within the church or someone outside of the church, what does it look like? What are the principles? What is important here? Well, let no one seek his own good, but the good of his neighbor. You know, to say I can do whatever I please is ultimately a statement of self-centeredness. But to say I can do as pleases my neighbor, whether it be my brother and sister in Christ or indeed my actual neighbor, is an outwardly focused, self-sacrificing way of living. Now, within the context of food, Paul goes on to describe how it is that should you receive an invitation from someone, maybe not a believer in Christ, And the food that they offer you, think this is in the context of first century Corinth, if the food that they offer you has possibly been offered to idols, then you shouldn't have a bad conscience about taking that food, because you're doing so for the good of the other. Paul refreshes and recaps this sense of, look, you know, if there's a believer and for the sake of their conscience, you need to say no to such foods, then you do so because you prefer one another within the church. You prefer one another in Christ. But as well as loving one another in the Christian church, we want to extend this as a gospel imperative of loving our neighbour. We go onto the other person's turf. We ought to just allow ourselves to be formed into their pattern of doing things. Over and over again, the Bible instructs us that we ought to be people who live at peace with others, who are respecting, even honouring the manner of living of other people. You know, Paul, as he concludes our verses for today, he says, give no offence to Jews or to Greeks or to the church of God, just as I try to please everyone in everything I do, not seeking my own advantage, but that of many, that they may be saved. Paul is clearly making the case that the way in which we respect and honour others and fit ourselves to their world, their culture, their practice, as long as it doesn't offend the gospel of God and his plan for our lives, this way, actually, it allows others to know that we care about them and that God loves them. It opens up doors of opportunity for the gospel. You know, elsewhere in the scriptures, in Romans 12, Paul says, if possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Far too many Christians who want to live at war with everybody they come across in the world, but this simply can't hold up scripturally. Jesus himself, when he's describing famously the church as salt and light, he says this in Mark 9, salt is good, but if the salt has lost its saltiness, how will you make it salty again? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. You know, it is imperative, it's integral to our Christianity that we be distinctive, that we be salty, as Jesus describes it, that we add savour, that we offer this distinctive tang within the world, if you can put it like that. But it doesn't mean that you ought to be an awkward so-and-so or belligerent, constantly seeking conflict. You can be salty and peaceable. Peter puts it like this, doesn't he, in his letter? He says, always be prepared to give a defense for the hope that you hold, but do so with gentleness and respect. It is perfectly possible to respectfully, gently, at peace with one another, be salty, allow for the gospel to come across, to really value the other, and in doing so, share the ultimate value of the individual, that is, our salvation in Jesus Christ. And so Paul applies that to the principle of what might be eaten in the context of if a friend should invite you around. Look, we look forward to the day, don't we, when we can again have dinner with others, invite folks around for some supper or some drinks or soon maybe even a barbecue in the garden and so on and so forth. But look, as you do so, what's your primary purpose? Is it to show off your culinary artistry? Well, you know, maybe so. But let it be for more. Let it be for friendship. Let it be for relationship. Let it be for honouring the other. Let it be for being at peace with one another, valuing one another, and then allowing others to know of their value in the economy of God and in the work of the cross. Just the last point on the subject of loving your neighbour. As a church, we're going to be partnering with lots and lots of other churches across the Wirral, the Liverpool City region, in helping to deliver something that's pioneered and facilitated by the Neighbourhood Prayer Network. If you want to know more about it, head to neighbourhoodprayer.net. And the principles are very clear. What they do is invite churches to partner, but more particularly individual Christians to take responsibility for their street in prayer. And to sign up, there's a wonderful little interactive map which looks great. My street is signed up on the map. And you can pray for the people on your street, the neighbours you know, maybe the people you don't yet know. Saying, God, let me just submit my life, my way of living, to sharing God's goodness with them. And a neighbourhood prayer offer a three-part, very simple way of loving your neighbour. It goes like this. Pray daily. Pray daily. And just every day you can pray for people, pray for those you know by name, pray for the others that you don't yet know, pray that you get to know them, but just pray for all of your neighbours, those who are moving into your street, those who are moving on, everything there. Pray daily, care weekly, find a way to offer some level of care to somebody in your street every week. You know, it might be as simple as taking the bins out or bringing their milk in, or just, you know, giving somebody a little card to say you're thinking of them, or helping somebody with their garden, or whatever it might be, or just spending, you know, 5 minutes talking with somebody if they would like to. So you pray daily, you care weekly, and share monthly. That is in some way, whether in a large way or a small way, to share something of the love of Jesus and of the gospel of Christ with the people on your street. So head to neighborhoodprayer.net. Why not sign yourself up right away? You don't need to wait for your pastor to fully announce these things. Sign up and do as the word of scripture tells us this evening. Let no one seek his own good, but the good of his neighbor. And here's the wonder. When you seek the good of your neighbor, when you're longing for your street, your neighborhood, to know the goodness of God, well, it's good for you too. We'll see this world changed. The love of Jesus bathes every part, and our hearts will be thrilled in the process. Now, God bless you in these things. Come on, let's pray. Jesus, we want to be people who are not focused on ourselves, but are focused on the other. We want to be people of invitation and of welcome. We want to be people who are willing to lay down our own personal preference for the sake of valuing our neighbours, our friends. Yes, valuing our brothers and sisters in Christ, those who are part of our church. That's incredibly precious. But extending that so that we can live at peace with others, so that we can share our faith with gentleness and respect, so that we can really, truly love those around us. Help us in these things. Fill us with your Spirit. Prompt us, Lord God. And let us, God, establish good rhythms of these things, practices which really bear fruit. In your name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Do add your comments. It'd be great to see some comments of people saying, I've signed up, praying for my street. And you'll hear more about this, no doubt, as we go along. God bless you. And may not see you here tomorrow. Alpha course, week three. Why did Jesus die? Huge question. Make sure you're there joining in. If you don't know about it yet, sign up. Send us a message and we will get you connected. God bless you. Good night.